And there came a day unlike any other, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Star Wars Comics Daily from Scorcher Hill, hosted by Brian Keown and Matt Wood. From Scorcher Hill, this is Star Wars Comics Daily. I'm Matt Wood.
And I'm Brian Keown.
Welcome to episode 114 of Star Wars Comics Daily, Star Wars number 29. Star Wars number 29 was released August 28th, 1979.
The writer slash editor is Archie Goodwin. The artists are Carmine Infantino and Bob Wycheck. Letterer is John Costanza. Colorist is Glynis Ween. And the cover is by Infantino and Wycheck.
Awesome. And we are joined today from someone who has worked on Star Wars comics before, the IDW series Star Wars Adventures. He's also worked on other things like Marvel's Unbeatable Squirrel Girl, Archie Comics, Jughead's Time Police, and numerous other comics. Derek Charm.
Hey, how's it going?
How's it going, Derek? Welcome to the show. Set the record straight about Star Wars Adventures real quick. Star Wars Adventures is technically canon, right?
It is canon, yeah. Everything we do goes through the story group and everything.
Okay.
But
you can't get away with things like what happens in this comic.
Right, yeah.
Okay.
More of like day in the life kind of stuff than big stories
right.
that we do.
So I'm just really curious about what it feels like going into a comic like this. So you've read a lot of these old classic Marvel Star Wars in the past, right?
Oh yeah, totally.
Yeah. So looking at this with, I guess, the experience that you've had working in Star Wars comics before, I don't know, is there any kind of like things that you notice or things that kind of jump out, or is it just an old comic book vibe?
No, I think it's like, it's really interesting because, the Star Wars itself wasn't super established at this point. Mm-hmm. So you kind of see things that you wouldn't see in modern Star Wars stuff now that there's like a very clear world of what this is. And then like just the stuff like the art style, like the writing style is all, it's much more open to interpretation in these older ones, which is really interesting. It's really cool.
Exactly. Yeah. We just wrapped up an episode last week where Jabba the Hutt, who is not a slug, confronts Han Solo, and Han gives Jabba the Hutt a ride on the Millennium Falcon with him grabbing on top of the Millennium Falcon and flying through space.
That's awesome.
Yeah. It seems like they're done. Like they're friends now, so it's no big deal anymore.
Yeah, right. Yeah. It ends with Jabba the Hutt saying, "Well, I guess we're even, Solo." And it's like, oh man, well, you guys didn't call that one right.
Yeah.
But, Brian, I believe you have the synopsis for Star Wars number 29, Dark Encounter.
I do.
Why don't you tell us what happens?
On board a Star Destroyer, Darth Vader tortures a spy looking for the name of a rebel deserter. Valance the Hunter has tracked the deserter named Tyler Lucian to a spaceport. He asks for info in a cantina and has to kill a suspicious barkeep and a couple of patrons. As he's leaving, he is stopped by a couple of stormtroopers. He identifies himself as a bounty hunter, so they're about to let him go when one of the troopers pulls back Valance's cloak, and sees that he is a dirty Borg. The stormtroopers are shocked that a Borg would kill normal organics, so Valance has to kill them too. At Rubyflame Lake, a lake that has been turned into a pool of corrosive wastewater by the Empire, Tyler Lucian muses aloud about the story of the farm boy who destroyed the Death Star, who he knows is named Luke Skywalker. Valance catches up to him and is ready to kill the deserter to keep that information from Vader, but the Sith Lord's TIE fighter flies over the lake, and Lucian uses the distraction to run into a nearby tower. Back on Yavin 4, Luke and 3PO have returned, and R2-D2 has been repaired. Jyn Dodonna tells Luke that he has a mission for him. Back at the lake, Valance and Vader face off. As they fight, Valance does pretty well, but Vader kicks a hole in the Borg's chest. Valance grabs Vader's leg and rolls into the lake. It looks like he might be able to pull Vader in, but Vader cuts off Valance's arm and escapes. Valance sinks into the lake, presumably dead. Vader turns to the tower just in time to see Lucian jump into the lake, taking his information into the afterlife with him. And that's the comic.
I think I went to camp at Lake Ruby Lake when I was a kid.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Don't go swimming in it, obviously. Well, I have to say that the first thing I got really excited for at the beginning of this issue was we have an appearance by my favorite Imperial, and that is, I don't know if he has a title, but it's Wormus.
Such a good name.
He has shown up a few times in the comic, and I don't understand. I guess it's just Vader needs someone to talk to.
Yeah, it seems sort of like he's his vague assistant, sort of, maybe, I guess.
Right. Well, his first few appearances, like, he talked back to Vader quite a bit. Like,
Yeah, he's the one who called him a boy or whatever.
Yeah, what he said, hey, my boy. Yeah. Which is like, no, don't do that. That doesn't seem right. Yeah. But I think they kind of, rolled back on that a little bit. And now Wormus is very much, you know, his name is very appropriate.
Right.
He seems a lot more cowardly. I thought that we were going to have a... Wormus is giving me the vibe of he's going to try to turn on Vader, but that hasn't happened yet, the whole indigestion thing.
I mean, surely he's been on the ship long enough that Vader has been treating him horribly, that he knows that, you know, he can't rise up anymore, he can't call him boy or any of that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it doesn't really work out. We have also a... I feel like a different torture droid. This isn't the classic Dr. Ball that we see in Star Wars. But still, I do once again love Carmine Infantino's Darth Vader.
I love it so much. It's so good. Yeah. His stormtroopers are amazing also.
Yeah, I love it's definitely a case of you have to remember 1979. I have to imagine that I'm surely Carmine Infantino has seen the movie. There are moments where I wonder if he's just cruising off of like publicity stills and nothing more.
Sure.
But you know, the movie's not readily available. You can't just like watch it whenever you want to. There's a lot of this that has to come from like memory. So things like, Dr. Ball, the torture droid, you have to imagine that they're like, well, we don't really have a picture of that anymore. So, it kind of looked like this, I guess. Yeah.
Well, that's what's cool about these older comics too, is that they have the freedom to sort of like, you know, interpret what that might be or what that is, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. And I just always love the weird and wacky directions that they go in. What do you guys feel about the Vader voice here? It doesn't quite seem, I mean, it's very, you know, Dr. Doom-esque, like, you know, comic book villain. But I don't know if it's quite Darth Vader. And, of course, I have, you know, 40-plus years of...
Right. I was going to say...
Yeah. But...
He doesn't really talk in that first movie.
Exactly, yeah. But I'm wondering if it's just... Am I... I don't know. I wish I could point to, like, one example outside of, I guess, the indigestion discussion.
That line is so strange, also. I don't understand exactly what he's saying.
Right.
About the indigestion.
It seems like, like Vader is kind of like enjoying, I guess, the torturing. And Vader's very much like, you know, with all the stuff we know about Vader now, it's like, oh, no, he's just indifferent about everything. But here he's just like, it's always fascinating. Huh, Wormus? Like, Wormus is just a weird, like, I don't know. Not quite. But I'm into it. Like just kind of enjoying, and also the stormtroopers on the first page getting really into it. That's always good. I guess we're going back to Centaurus, and I had to look this up, Brian, but apparently we've been to Centaurus before.
Okay. Do they actually call it Centaurus? I didn't look too deep into it, but I didn't see anywhere where they say what name the planet they're even on.
Yeah. They do refer to it as Centaurus. I think closer to the, maybe I might actually need to walk back on that, because I think Lake, what is it, Ruby Lake, or what is
the... Rubyflame Lake.
Thank you. I might be thinking this is all the same location, but it may not be. So
yeah, I don't. Yeah, they're they're sort of vague about exactly where they are, except for the Rubyflame Lake.
Well, this is the first time that Valance... So Valance, every issue he's been in, which at this point has been like five, the way that he reveals that he's a cyborg, it's... You always want to be something like here, this one works because he gets shot in the face and it's like, oh, okay, hey, he's a cyborg. But every appearance before this, he rips off his face for no reason, just, I guess, to show the reader, oh, remember, I'm part robot.
Yep.
Yeah. But I was a big fan of the bartender Valance breaking his, like, punching through the bar. And like grabbing his...
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, that worked for me. But yeah, getting shot in the face and being revealed to be the Borg. I find it ironic that still about Borg prejudice. Which,
yeah, it's so weird.
Like most things, you know, like this isn't established in the movie, so it's
right.
It's, you know, obviously the Marvel creators trying to create something new because, you know, like we've talked about before, like they can't have Luke meet Vader. They have certain like things they can't cross the line on. But, you know, for most things, they have pretty much free range. But it is funny those few times where they make a judgment call on something and it's something that is almost immediately contradicted in the movies, like when Empire Strikes Back comes out.
Right. Half the characters are cyborgs.
Right, exactly.
It's like a pretty common thing.
Yeah. But your boss is a cyborg, guys. Like,
it's so weird that when you see, in some of the, like even the Dark Horse comics, I think we've seen people where they're, you know, they're missing a hand or something. It's like, why don't you just get a robot hand?
Yeah. They're right over there. I mean, everyone, apparently it's like the easiest thing. If the Rebel Alliance can just like pop one on, you know, like they should be, you know, shoestring budget, but I guess not. Okay. So I guess it makes sense for bounty hunters to have like licenses and in real life, do bounty hunters have like cards that say I'm a bounty hunter?
Probably. I know. I mean, this is all coming from TV shows. So who knows how real it is, but I mean, Private Eyes have to have license. So I would assume a bounty hunter has to. I don't remember if the Fall Guy had a license or not, but I assume he did.
I haven't watched an episode of Dog in a while.
Yeah.
Everyone seems to know like who Dog the Bounty Hunter is, like on Hawaii. So they all seem to be cool with it.
Yeah.
But, you know, also like the jurisdiction on Valance is pretty impressive. It's about 29 systems. Is that what he says? Yeah.
Oh, does it? Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Even though,
28 systems. Well, this including this one. That's 29. Yeah. You're right. 29.
Yeah, exactly. Come on. Don't argue with these made up numbers, Brian. But yeah.
There's another really cool Stormtrooper face on this page where he shows the driver's license. It's like a profile. The shape is like a little distorted.
Yeah. Awesome. It's so good. Like I
love it.
Infantino, he draws everything slightly like, I don't want to say distorted, but like wider than they, you know, would normally appear. Like his R2-D2, we always kind of joke is, you know, he's like 3 feet wide. You know? And the Stormtroopers are no, like the TIE Fighters, for example, are the same way. But the Stormtroopers, right. Exactly, yeah, they fit the bill. And they look awesome. What do you think about the name Tyler Lucian?
I don't know. It seems kind of pedestrian, but I mean, and Luke Skywalker is one of those. It's like, okay, well, it's just a guy's name. So
there's no like system to naming in Star Wars. About right. Anything.
The last name has to be weird and semi spacey, but the first name I think can be, you know, just kind of average.
But yeah. Ben, Luke, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. But, it, you know, it's going to be... there's like a ratio. The more normal and earthy the first name, the more wild and, like, kind of crazy the last name needs to be. So, like, Luke, that Skywalker and, you know, Tyler Lucian. I don't know. Maybe Lucian's not that crazy of a name.
That just makes me think of Sandman. That's what the librarian from Sandman's named Lucian. So...
When I first was flipping through this comic without reading it, I thought that this was Luke, and I got really excited at the possibility of Luke with like stubble.
Meaning, he's been sleeping on the streets for a while because his clothes are all ripped up too.
I don't think we've ever seen Luke with a beard.
Yeah, I don't think so. Now that you say that.
Oh, what am I talking about? Of course,
I the guess sequel trilogy. Old man, yeah,
exactly.
Oh, well, yes. Well, I'm thinking young Luke. I'm not
right,
thinking.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I almost forgot there's like three movies where like.
Right.
But yeah, young Luke. There's no sense of stubble or anything. So it would. But yes, this is not Luke. This is just another blonde kid that Balance is hunting down.
yeah, because somehow he knows the name Luke Skywalker.
He bumped into Luke, remember? And Art and C-3PO taught him about how it's okay to be a robot.
Oh, was that the same guy?
Wait, no, we're talking about Balance, right?
No, not Balance. No, Balance. Yes, I remember. But this Lucian guy. How
does he know? I have no idea who this guy is. This guy's not.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Well, his story is cool. It's that he abandoned like right as the Death Star was approaching because he thought it was a lost cause.
Right.
Immediately found out he was wrong.
He took the coward's way out left and is hanging out at Lake Battery Acid Ruby, or whatever it's called.
Rubyflame, dude.
Rubyflame Lake. Sorry. Which you know. The more you start to think about it, it's like, how is there a dock? How does that work? Like, if it's made of metal and it will dissolve metal. Yeah, but oh well.
You
just got to let that stuff go. I think at this point, Balance has decided, because Balance has put on fake skin over and over and over again. I think at this point, he's just like, you know what? I'm done. I'm sick of repairing my face.
Yeah, and I mean, theoretically, there's a time aspect to it. I mean, he runs off to get him. To get Lucian, so I would assume he just doesn't have time to go put that skin back on.
Yeah. Oh well, he got distracted with Darth Vader's TIE fighter. I do love the exposition text, but a moment is far more than Tyler Lucian thought he had, and he grasped it desperately, using it to race for Sanctuary. I love that very old comic booky.
He's fast, too. He gets over to that tower real quick.
Yeah, exactly. Well, he's desperate, Brian.
I mean, I guess he's used to running because he's a coward.
Exactly. Yeah, there you go. Speaking of R2-D2 and our very wide R2-D2, it turns out he is not as... he's been repaired since our last appearance.
Well, yeah, they went and got the supplies last issue.
I want to say he looks slightly different, but I think it's just Carmine drawing him very low to the ground.
Yeah. And he's turned sideways. He's not face front. Like, I think if he was face front, he would look a lot wider than he, you know, like he would in the way they normally draw him.
Derek, I have a question.
Yes.
Okay. Let's say you're Jan Dodonna. You work for the Rebel Alliance.
Okay.
All right. You're stationed on Yavin. You'll destroy the Death Star. How long do you stay on Yavin after the Death Star has been destroyed?
I feel like I would leave right away.
You're wrong. Feel like
that is apparently that idea has not yet occurred. In both Legends and canon, they stay on Yavin. They stay on Yavin a lot less in canon.
Did they stay in Yavin and canon?
Well, it's enough for Leia to like go on her adventure and come back, and they're still in Yavin.
Oh, you're talking about? Oh, you're right. That's right. The Princess Leia comic book.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but in Legends, in these comics, they're on Yavin.
Yeah, this is issue 29. Yeah, they're still there.
Yeah, exactly. It's
they're not even talking about Elite
Empire, right?
I don't know when they officially leave Yavin in these comics, but we are getting close to. I'm pretty sure the Empire Strikes Back comic happens around like issue 40 something.
So we're not super far away from it. Yeah, I think 38 is the first. No, 39 is the first issue of Empire. We got 10 issues.
10 issues. I'm starting to think that they will be on Yavin until that movie comes out.
Could be. Yeah.
Yeah. But they are cool temples. I mean.
And they aren't looking for someplace else. I mean, they've sent Luke out to look for other places.
Right. I mean, what about Lake Rubyfire?
No, Darth Vader's right there, dude.
Oh, that's true. You're right. You're right. Good. Good observation. What are your feelings, Derek, towards Jan Zadonna?
This is this old rebel guy?
Yeah. He's in the movie, and just like most things in Star Wars, if it appears in the movie for 1 or 2 seconds, he will show up all the time in comic books and movies and
right.
any other.
I'm not super familiar with him, so I don't know. What's his story?
He's kind of a jerk.
Oh, okay.
He's very patronizing toward Leia, for sure.
Right, exactly.
Well, that's why he never showed up again.
Yeah, well, they Kieran Gillen killed him.
Really?
In canon, yeah.
And he's in Rogue One, isn't he?
He does show up in Rogue One, and I think he's in that scene where they're like all gathered around listening to Jyn Erso. And I think even then he says something jerk, like, "Oh, your dad's an Imperial? Yeah, let's trust you." Yeah. So even then, it's like, you know. There's no appearance of Jan Dodonna where he looks great, except for, you know, Star Wars.
Right.
Yeah.
I like the image of Darth Vader on a dock as the sun goes down.
One hand on his
head. Yeah, exactly. Are you about to pull a gun? See, this is another thing that I find really interesting. We don't see Vader with a gun, but isn't it in that one Obi-Wan like one shot that we did, Brian, I don't think they've fully established that Jedi Knights didn't have guns.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah,
I guess not, because I mean, yeah, certainly. I mean, you know, Luke has a blaster sometimes, so.
And like Dark Empire too, yeah. Luke is always carrying around a blaster. I think it's not into the prequels where it's like, no, they never used them. They never used them. But like I think around this time, so I don't know. Vader's not, you know, having his hand on the hip like, you know, like a gunslinger or something. But that was the image that popped into my mind.
Yeah.
Which then raises the question: why carry a blaster if you're Valance, if you can just shoot lasers out of your hand like Iron Man?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes he's trying to keep that under wraps.
I guess you're totally right. Yeah.
He doesn't want everybody to know the board. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, when you're already exposed as a cyborg, I guess you can use it as much as you want. But if you're, you know, trying to keep everything under wraps, but.
Yeah, he does use it to throw off Vader.
Yeah, and it totally works, which is kind of disappointing. Vader's a little distracted here, I think. Maybe he has indigestion like Wormus. Yes. As you know, you get it after you eat and not before.
Yes.
There's another panel in here where he gets punched in the face during this fight. It's just not something you're used to seeing.
Yeah. It's very much... it's things that I would love to see Darth Vader do. And we're getting those in these comics, but we never get them later. Like, yeah, if you punch Darth Vader... I mean, I guess if you have a robot hand, that helps.
Yeah, I guess. Right?
Yeah. If I didn't have a robot hand and I punched him, that would probably be a bad idea.
Yeah, you're punching a helmet. It'd be just like punching a stormtrooper, which doesn't seem to be a problem most of the time. But
yeah, I mean, you have Ewoks throw a rock at him and that kills him.
R2 throws a book at Boba Fett and knocks him out.
Knocks him out, yeah.
Exactly. I do like Darth Vader like jumps over the bridge and like kicks him down, sort of like Captain Kirk does or something.
Yeah, nice drop kick with the lightsaber too. You know, he could have easily just led in with the lightsaber, but he's like, nah. Yeah, I think Vader shows that he's kind of down with Valance here.
Oh yeah, I mean, I think that's like kind of the point of this is that he like sees him as kind of an equal, but obviously not as good.
It seems, you know, once again, here's hindsight talking, but we hear, you know, Vader using this whole, like, join me, you know, become my ally stuff, you know, because of Empire. But we don't really get that in, like, Star Wars. So when he's saying this at the Valance, it's like, oh, maybe in a different
just
universe.
Just offering it to everybody.
Yeah, exactly. he doesn't know who might be his kid, so he's just kind of offering it to anyone in hopes that... yeah, this guy could be my kid. He's about the same age.
that was Tyler Lucian's big mistake, is that Vader just wanted to join up. He wasn't going to kill him or anything.
Vader's just looking for it's a big brother, little brother kind of situation.
Right.
I love the sound effect, the krong, when Vader gets punched. That's a good one. So does he kick a hole in Valance's chest, or does he...
When I did the synopsis, I thought he was, but it looks like now he kicks him, and then Valance punches him, and then Vader like smashes his chest with his hand. So
that's
goes wrong when I was doing it.
Yeah, well, that's pretty sweet.
But I do kind of like the idea that he just kicked a big hole in him though.
Yeah.
Instead.
I mean, if anyone could do it, it's Darth Vader.
Sure.
Which I guess that also means, I mean, how much? Okay, so a cyborg, you know, like Cyborg and just or Teen Titans. If there's any amount of organic person in the robot, then they're a cyborg regardless. Like, when does it stop becoming a cyborg and when does it become a robot?
Yeah, I think if you don't have any organic parts, you're just a robot.
Okay.
I think if you've got organic, Darth Vader's a cyborg. I mean,
right.
I'm sure they didn't know that then, but you know, we know that Obi-Wan chopped his arms and legs off. So,
is it the brain? Like, does the brain have to be there?
I mean, I would assume so.
That feels right. Yeah,
it's like General Grievous was just like a heart and some of a face.
Yeah,
yeah,
maybe like one lung or something because he's always coughing. But yeah,
right.
It's not much of a guy anymore. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. I feel like. Because, you know, without the brain, then it's, like, just artificial. Like, you can't put, like, a human eyeball into a robot and say, oh, no, sorry, cyborg.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
That'd be something different than a robot, but probably not.
Yeah.
A whole different thing.
It's I don't want to go around throwing names at, you know, anything, but, yeah. I do feel like there has to be a line that, you know, okay, now you are technically a cyborg. So that then raises the question, how much of Valance is machine?
I think they've said that it's like his half of his body.
Okay.
I think he's like Tharok from Legion Superheroes and that guy from that number 9 or whatever that we saw.
There you go.
Where he's like half and half. Yeah. At least it's half his head and that same arm.
Brian, you don't have to work Legion of Superheroes into Star Wars. Dude,
it's not me, man.
You're right.
Probably not actually even Goodwin is probably
I mean, Carmine was definitely working over there at the time when Legion was getting popular. Yeah, sure. So yeah. But yeah. Brian, I think you called it. Last week you mentioned that Valance goes down Terminator 2 style.
Oh my god. If he had been given a thumbs up, that would have been so amazing.
it doesn't slowly sink, but yeah, wow. When you're into the
it's not really lava either, but it's still very reminiscent of Terminator 2.
It's not lava in Terminator 2, right?
It's liquid metal.
Liquid metal, yeah, which is kind of
basically lava.
Yeah, exactly. When does it stop becoming lava, and when does it become?
Well, I guess lava's rock, liquid rock. So I guess it's not lava. Yeah.
Hey, we're not geologists. We talk about Star Wars comics. Come on.
Right.
If you came here for that, you're at the wrong podcast. Do you think Vader keeps Valance's hand?
I was wondering that too.
Yeah.
Could be. We could draw some more lines to Terminator 2 and keep his hand in jar or something, because they did that in Terminator 2 as well.
Mm-hmm. That's how we,
But I don't know. Vader doesn't seem like much of a trophy kind of guy.
He is now. Isn't like Vader's castle just, I mean... Hey, Derek, you worked on Vader's castle. Isn't there a whole trophy room there?
Yeah, he's got like suits of armor and stuff. Apparently, they were like there was a video. It's a video game was doing all the development on that. So then, as they came up with something, we would work it into the book. So there's probably been more even added since then. So
was Valance's hand in there?
Yes, for sure.
Okay,
I'm making it official.
You heard it here first, folks. Valance's hand, even though he's in the Marvel comics now, one of his hands made it into he's a cyborg. You just grow another hand, right?
Well, I didn't grow it, but
they're attached. Okay.
It looks like he leaves things around like pretty often, so.
Yeah. I mean, if he's comfortable ripping off his face every other panel, then I'm sure attaching a hand is no biggie to him.
For sure.
I love the fingernails scratching the like dock as Vader's like grabbing on like dragging like that's just how bad Vader doesn't want to fall into like Ruby Fire Lake.
Well, dude, I mean, again, it's not lava, but I mean, he's got to be pretty afraid of lava at this point.
Oh man,
Him to die there.
He's like, not again.
Yeah. Not like this.
Yeah. I have the high ground this time. It shouldn't happen like this. But yeah, poor Valance. Technically, Valance now doesn't die. Even though this is his last appearance, he comes back in, what is it? It's Star Wars 108, the comic that they put out 2 years ago or so.
Yeah.
I have to imagine they find a way to retcon this. But I have no idea.
Yeah, I don't remember. I've read it, but it's been a while since I've read it, so I don't remember if they even explain how he's back.
Well, I guess we're going to have to talk about Tyler Lucian and his leap of faith.
It was a great... I wasn't expecting that. It was pretty shocking.
Yeah, it's always a dark turn whenever we go this direction in a Star Wars comic.
Yeah, because especially in these days, this is theoretically a kid's comic, so just suicide seems like a big move.
Yeah, it's a pretty hard last page. Yeah. Also, you know, when they set up the whole, you know, he left Yavin right before the Death Star because he was afraid and everything. And like, I don't know, maybe you get that last page and you're just like, we only have one more page. We can't have this guy like stand up and fight Vader or whatever. I just feel like it's kind of a bummer to watch Tyler just jump out. Maybe, however, here's my other theory. Tyler has like a decoy a la Ferris Bueller's Day Off. And he throws that into the lake.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah. And
yeah, that is a good question. You think Vader went up and checked, or did he just like, yeah, that guy jumped in and just moves on?
I mean, I feel like if you're Darth Vader and you're like the powerful Lord of the Sith, like just use the Force, catch him before he does this.
That did occur to me, but I don't think we even know that they can do that right now. Right?
I was going to say that. Yeah. I don't think that they established the holding things in space.
Yeah, I think isn't.
Do we see any levitation in Star Wars? Like the first Star Wars?
I think he just chokes that guy is the most he does. But you don't see anyone move anything.
Wow. Yeah, you're totally right. That's Empire Strikes Back with the lightsaber in the cave, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, my goodness. All right. Well, sorry, Tyler. You should have held off until 1981. I mean, you would have died anyway. Oh, what are we talking about?
There's only 10 more issues, dude. Come on, you could have done it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, poor Tyler. Oh, well, Vader didn't get that name. He never learns that Luke Skywalker is Luke Skywalker, which, you know, now since we're like, what, 10 issues away from the beginning of Empire Strikes Back's adaptation, do you think they cover Vader discovering Luke's name in the comics?
I don't know. It depends on when they had access to that script. Because, I mean, obviously, you know, the Jason Aaron stuff, we can do that because we know what happens.
Oh, sure.
In the movies, but yeah, they have no idea what's going to happen in the next movie, I would assume. Hmm.
Okay, next bet. Do you think Wormus dies before Empire Strikes Back?
Dies? I don't know, because again, it's like, what's his name? Not Piet, but the guy that Piet replaces. That's kind of the first, like, I'm just going to kill you because you're incompetent kind of a thing.
Like Ozzel?
Yeah. So I don't know.
Derek, where are you standing on Wormus's fate?
I'm trying to think about it. I want to look him up now because I'm sure it's established somewhere.
Wormus is a character that I think is ripe for a return.
I'll bring it up.
Okay,
it's too good of a name just to let it go.
Yeah, pass that. You know, if this podcast, you know, can make any kind of dent. And it's a Wormus-sized dent, then that's a... Oh, no, guys. Apparently, he's kind of canon, according to Wikipedia. He has a tab on canon, but he's referred to as unidentified Imperial captain aboard the Devastator. I don't think that makes him Wormus.
Yeah, yeah. If you're not identified, that literally
they
means
just picked a random character and said that's Wormus.
Yeah. However, Wormus has a first name, Mulchive.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's an awful name.
Yeah. Yeah. The new favorite Star Wars character.
Yeah. Mulchive Wormus. Yeah. Pretty good name. Man, I'm my fingers are crossed for Wormus, but I don't know. He doesn't show up in Empire, so that's not a good sign.
Yeah, I would imagine if he doesn't die, he at least fades off into obscurity, sadly.
Maybe he gets to retire and live comfortably, Brian.
That seems like something the Imperials get to do a lot.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I like to have a hope, an optimistic outlook towards these things. All right, well, that's going to wrap it up. Next week, we're looking at Star Wars, A Princess Alone, because, well, I guess Leia's out doing something.
Yep.
Refusing to sit still like Jan Dodonna constantly wants her to do, which is good. Derek,
yes.
Now we're turning to you. Tell us your Star Wars story. Like, when did you first get into Star Wars? And
oh, I mean, like, as a kid, got into it, you know, like as movies and stuff. But yeah, when they started talking about doing this kid series at IDW, they asked like a whole bunch of artists to sort of pitch like what they would do, because there wasn't a lot of Star Wars stuff. It was right when Disney bought it, like it was pretty early. So yeah, we just sent in like some sample pages and stuff, and they ended up asking me to do the like announcement art for that. And then we were just worked into, there's sort of a rotating group of artists on that book, and I'm usually with Captain Scott as the writer.
Nice.
And yeah, I got to go out to Lucasfilm.
Okay, like, so come on.
And like, yeah,
we had Heather Antos on the podcast, and we love Lucasfilm stories. So if whatever
it was,
you can
one
share.
Of the best things I've ever done. It's such a cool place to be, and like very inspiring, and makes you just want to do the best you can do.
We heard about the cereal bar.
Yeah.
And we heard about the Ninja Turtle. What was the thing that made you flip out the most when you went to Lucasfilm?
Yeah, no, there's people are always surprised to hear this, but there's a, because ILM did the special effects for like everything. Mm-hmm. And above this guy's desk, I probably have nothing allowed to say this, but above this guy's desk is like the entire saucer section of the Enterprise.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
Like, it's as big as like my wall. It's huge. It's like a miniature they used. And that like literally like stopped me in my tracks when I saw it, which I know it's not awesome. Star Wars related, but still.
I think that's how like any trip to Lucasfilm would go, is like, oh yeah, you're expecting to see the Star Wars stuff.
Exactly, right.
Yeah, but when you see like the Scolari brothers from Ghostbusters 2, it's like, oh wait, no, I wasn't expecting to see that. That's amazing.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it was Heather mentioned the Ninja Turtle. Like that was the one that like kind of blew her away, right?
So it's everything that's not Star Wars that.
Right, yeah. I'm sure the Star Wars stuff is awesome.
It's very awesome.
Yes. Yeah, but you always want to hear about the other stuff too. And
so
we're now keeping a list. Next time we have someone else on, I want to hear what they're
totally.
I was disappointed to find out that the bathrooms are not very theatrical or anything, that they're just standard restrooms.
They're nice though. It's like, it's a very pretty building, so
yeah.
I give the bathrooms a thumbs up,
but I want to hear like lightsabers ignite when you flush the toilets and stuff like that. That's what I want. So like, what was your first like Star Wars experience? Was it the prequels? Was it were you a pre-prequel Star Wars fan, or was it post-prequels?
Yeah, I was pre-prequel. I was born in 82, so it was like kind of right around the original. Nice. But I'm very into the prequels. Like I love those movies. Like, say what you will about the quality, I think there's a lot of like really cool artistry in those.
Absolutely.
But yeah, so I mean, pretty much just my entire life, I've like had some relationship with Star Wars. You know, I did read all the comics, like not all of them, but I read a lot of them back when they were Dark Horse back in the day. And it was
Nice.
It's very surreal to like be working on them now.
I can imagine. I can imagine that being the sensation of like this thing that you know, you're familiar with and you're into for all these years, to just all of a sudden like, oh wow, I'm kind of carrying the torch here for a second, you know.
Right. Yeah. And like the art style for the series was so like, it was more cartoony. They wanted it to be cartoony.
Mm-hmm.
And like, you just aren't used to seeing Star Wars stuff like that. So I was always like, is this right? Are we doing this right?
Yeah, I actually love that stuff. I'm obviously, I love the comics regardless. I mean, what are we doing here? You know,
right. Right.
But when, you know, the Marvel stuff kind of leaned in more to like, not necessarily photorealistic, but keeping things very by the book, not really leaning into like the cartoony illustration. I don't know. I always kind of felt like, oh, it's kind of a bummer, because you know, it's that, that's more of the comic book I would normally gravitate towards.
Same, yeah.
Yeah.
I was really relieved because I've worked for other licenses where there's not a lot of interpretation allowed, but mm-hmm. Michael Siglin, who's the creative director at Lucasfilm Publishing, was like, please just go like do wild colors. He's like, go as far as you want, and then if we have to pull it back, we could pull it back. But it wasn't like try to make celebrity likenesses or anything like that.
Nice.
That's cool.
Were there any pieces of feedback that you were kind of like surprised by? Brian, you were telling me about who was the artist?
Drew Moss. Yeah, he didn't realize Jabba had a tattoo, so he had to go back and redraw all the tattoos on Jabba's arm.
No idea. Oh man, there's so much. Like, cause a lot of Star Wars is just kind of suggested. It's never like explicitly stated. So like Jabba the Hutt having a tattoo, like you would never know if someone didn't tell you.
Yeah.
But I feel like there's always something that I'm completely surprised by.
Cool. Brian,
sorry, I don't know.
No, it's cool. I mean, we hey, you know, now we know about the Enterprise. Like that's the we any snippet is
juicy information.
Yeah, that's we're good with it. Brian, got any questions?
No, I don't know. Do you have anything coming up, Derek? I mean, again, we're in this weird time where who knows when comics are coming out again, but
we're actually, we have a Clone Wars Battle Tales miniseries.
Oh yeah.
That's right.
Written by Michael Morisi that was supposed to come out every week in April, and it's finished. Yeah. And I have the first issue here, but it delayed till March. So
yeah,
that's the next Star Wars thing, but it's done. So, and it looks really good. There's like, cool. There's different artists. I do the wraparound each issue. It's sort of like Vader's castle, and then they like will tell a story, and that'll be a different artist. So
that's cool. That's awesome. I like that a lot. I like that approach. I think Michael. We've talked to Michael in the past. We had a scheduling conflict. It was right at the height of like the world shutting down. So we ended up having to reschedule. I think Michael's going to be on the show pretty soon in the near future. So that should be exciting.
Tell him I said hi.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no, it's exciting. I love. I love the art style. I think I told you in the email we met in at New York. I guess it was, what was that, 2018, right?
Yeah.
I gave you a list of, that's how I do my Star Wars commissions, is I have a list of a bunch of characters, and I usually just let the artist, like, hey, whatever you want to do, go nuts. And you picked Bib Fortuna, and I was like, yeah, all right.
I remember that, yeah.
Yeah. So this guy gets it. And it's easily one of my favorites, just because you captured Bib Fortuna in his very Bib Fortuna-ness.
I don't think he's a character I've drawn officially yet either, so it's kind of fun.
Well, do you know the wild story about Bib Fortuna? We learned this through doing the podcast. Apparently, Bib Fortuna has a wild, wacky post-Return of the Jedi future.
Oh, yeah?
So, apparently he didn't die when the sail barge blew up.
Okay.
Because I don't know how that happens, how that works. You know, how do you escape that? I saw that thing blow up. But whatever. sure. You know, he found a I don't know, an escape pod or something.
But people get thrown out of explosions and live. Come on.
There you go. Yeah, sure. Bib Fortuna looks like he's in good health.
Sure.
But apparently he goes back to the palace. he assumes command of the palace, but the Bomar monks, those like spiders with like brains in a jar that like walk around Jabba's palace, they apparently take over, take his brain out of his head and put it into one of those spider robots, and he becomes like a Bomar monk until like Wedge and a bunch of the other guys in Rogue Squadron like spend some time at Jabba's palace for whatever reason. And it's just this kind of weird, like, why would Wedge ever meet Bib Fortuna? Why is Bib Fortuna's brain in a spider robot? Which makes Bib Fortuna a cyborg.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
What was this in? That sounds amazing.
I think we found out that like it's in a Tales from Jabba's Palace, the book, the collection of short stories. But I also think it's picked up in an issue of Rogue Squadron.
Yeah, it's got to be where Wedge comes in. Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't think it's in like the Rogue Squadron novels. I think it was the comic book from Dark Horse.
I think so because we're excited we're going
to
get to it.
Yeah, we're absolutely thrilled that's going to be, you know, every once in a while we discover a nugget of like, hey, you know, if you're really committing to doing every issue of Star Wars, good news is there are some you know, nuggets of gold that you're going
right,
to
sure.
get there. And we can't wait to get to spider-brained Bib Fortuna hanging out with Wedge and Tillys.
I'm looking that up tonight.
Yeah, well, hey, happy to pass it on.
Thank you.
We give you that. You find a way to give us Wormus. We'll call it even.
Wormus is coming. Okay. That's the worst thing I do. I promise.
It's amazing. Awesome. Well, thank you, Derek. I really appreciate it. Where can the people get in touch with you?
I'm on Twitter, Derek_Charm, or Instagram, just Derek Charm. That's kind of all I have right now.
Excellent. Well, make sure you check out Derek's social media. And make sure you come back tomorrow because we're going to be looking at River of Chaos, not rivers, right, Brian?
Yeah, there's just one river.
There's one river. And we're, that connects to Lake Ruby Fire Lake.
Probably.
Yeah. But yeah, River of Chaos number 2 from Star Wars Comics Daily. I'm Matt Wood.
And I'm Brian Kuhn.
And until tomorrow, may the Force be with you.